Thank you all for coming. Thanks to Alyssa and the Local First group for bringing me out here. I've told this to a few people, but and I really don't mean it as flattery. What you have in Grand Rapids is unusual, and you should guard it closely, because what you have is a community in which business, NGOs, and government are actually working together on a daily basis to try and address some of the social and environmental challenges that we all face. And that just doesn't happen everywhere. Just in, there are a few communities that I've seen around the country that are this active and this vibrant in this area. So I'm an admirer, and I will look forward to seeing what you're doing. What Alyssa didn't mention, that she was responsible, or Local First was responsible, for creating for B Corp a shorter assessment that any business could use to go through a less onerous process to self-assess your own business practices. And did this, test piloted it for the Grand Rapids community, and it's now been adopted by the City of New York as a program. The City of New York would like to see half its, how many of its businesses?
What?
How many?
70.
Yeah. In New York?
Oh, half the businesses in New York they're trying to take through it in 10 years.
Right. So, and this is not to make half of the businesses in New York B Corps, but to have those businesses go through a self-assessment of their social and environmental impact on their employees, their customers, and their community. I'd like to start out by kind of set the frame for the conversation by mentioning three quotes. And the first is from Sun Also Rises by Ernest Hemingway, who spent his summers up at Traverse City. And it's one character asks another, he says, Mike, how did you go bankrupt? And Mike says, oh, two ways. Gradually, then suddenly. And the second quote is from Aldo Leopold, who was our first kind of systems ecologist and wildlife biologist on a big scale, who wrote, he said, a thing is right that tends to support the integrity, stability, and beauty of the biotic community. And this statement, I think, is unchallengeable. Yet, what we do every day in the course of our work tends to disrupt the beauty, stability, and integrity of the biotic community. And the third quote comes from A River Runs Through It by Norman MacLean. And there was the main character is a young fly fisherman in Montana, and his father is a Presbyterian minister. And they're referring to the greenhorns that come up from the city. And in attempting to learn how to fly fish, just kind of grab the rod and point it at the water, or point it toward the fish they want. And anybody who's ever tried fly fishing, that will land your line either on your ear or on the bank, but nowhere near the fish you're aiming for. And what you need to do when you're fly fishing is to pause at the top of your cast and wait for the line that you can't see extend itself all the way back. And then, by the rhythm, by establishing a certain rhythm, you cast that forward. And the line of the Presbyterian minister is, mankind has always tried to attain power without recovering grace. And I think that that's the situation that we find ourselves in 2015. That we have, as a people, as a species, we have extraordinary power over materials, over nature, over ourselves in some ways. But what we have done is to attain power without recovering grace, without understanding adequately what our role is in the larger frame of things. And as a consequence, we have not only social problems, but we have an environmental crisis on our hands. I think for the next 40 years, I use 40 years a lot because I've worked for Patagonia for off and on for 40 years, and for me it's now a frame of time that I can understand. I certainly didn't understand it when I was 20, but I can see it now. And I'm working a lot with students, with graduate students who are starting out careers that are going to last about 40 years. So now I can look at imagine nearly 80 years of work or a century of work. And so what I think is the next 40 years, it really is going to be our task in business and our task as citizens to recover grace, to recover the capacity of the natural world to heal itself, and also to come to some better understanding of how to work together. When I talk to people who are just starting out working, I sometimes point out what it was like in 1973 when I started work at Patagonia. And there are a lot of differences. The world population was 4.3 billion. The world population is now 7 billion. And by the time the young people I'm working with will retire, the world population is going to be 9 billion, but more significant, another 2, 3, or 4 billion people will have left the farms in a subsistence life in China and in India and on the African continent. They'll be joining the middle class. The size of the economy, so we've not quite doubled the population during my working life. The size of the economy is 5 times what it was in 1973. And it's this combination of population pressure and economic activity of changing things, of making things, that is producing the pressure on environmental systems. Another story, you know, that people don't find it kind of hard to believe, in 1973, they hadn't taken the lead out of gasoline, and so when you would get out of your car in Los Angeles in the summertime, you start to cough or your eyes would start to tear, and that was just a regular part of life. Younger people gasp when you tell them that the Cuyahoga River used to catch fire, which it did fairly regularly in Cleveland from its chemicals. And my favorite nightmare story is that in Lake Ontario, you could develop black and white film by dipping it in the water. You wouldn't get a very crisp image, but the chemicals were close enough to what was required to develop in a developing bath that you'd get an image. So some important legislation came about in those years. It was bipartisan. It was for clean air, for clean water. But those were the most obvious problems, and it's the kind of obvious problem, for instance, that Beijing now faces with its smog. But most of the problems that are causing a downward pressure on environmental health are not so visible. In the past 40 years, we have seen climate change become very real. We have been losing topsoil at a rather astonishing rate, and it takes a century to recover an inch of topsoil. We have seen the loss of so much groundwater and underground water in the fossil aquifers, and the water that does remain is being polluted by agricultural runoff. In the situation in California where I live, aside from the drought, the Colorado River only meets the ocean about 20 days a year. And in China, it's forecast that none of the major rivers that are really the lifelines for the population will meet the sea by 2025. The ocean, which has sequestered our carbon from our industrial activities for the past 150 years, has finally lost its capacity to do that, so it's turning acidic. And the more acid it turns, the more it destroys the hard shells of the small forms of life that all marine life require. All of this is kind of hard to see in bits and pieces. You know it if you're a climber and you go to a climbing spot and the glacier's gone. You know it if you're a commercial fisherman in Maine and it takes you longer to run your boat out to get the haddock and you know that the cod isn't there anymore. You know it if you're a wildlife biologist, if you're a biologist of any kind. You see it as a crisis. But we don't in general. We don't see it. The fact that that fisherman has to go out farther to get his haddock is not headline news in the New York Times. I want to talk a little bit about our journey and when we started as a company, our understanding of what nature was very different from what has come to be today. Our idea of nature in 1973, and I'm speaking a kind of collective we, because I worked the Patagonia when it was still a mountain climbing equipment company, very small group of employees when I started. Everyone was a climber or a surfer, except for me and the 55-year-old bookkeeper. I came to work because I was Yvonne's nephew, and I was working in the car wash, and I wanted to make money to go back to Europe, and Yvonne paid $2.25 an hour, and I was making $1.50 an hour, so this was a big move for me. And moreover, I'd mentioned that the culture was so strongly oriented toward what people love to do, to the surfing and the climbing, that we used to get a bonus of 10% for each week we worked 40 hours. Because nobody wanted to work 40 hours, except for the 55-year-old bookkeeper and me. So, but one of the things I started to learn from the people I worked with was this love of where they played. And it wasn't just the sheer joy or pleasure, though that was a lot of it. But if you go into the mountains, anybody who's done that, you know that once you get a mile from the road, you start to feel vulnerable. You feel vulnerable to the weather. You feel vulnerable to rockfall. You start to understand the beauty of nature, which is more beautiful than anything man-made. And you get a sense of awe that's very difficult to have in the social web of the city. And the same thing happens for surfers when they just get a little bit out from the sand. They're dealing with the force of the wind and the force of the waves, and they're playing with those forces. So what those folks had was a really strong sense of wanting to protect those places, protecting surf breaks, of protecting the mountains. So that was easy for us. It was much harder for us in 1973 to view where we worked or where we lived as the natural world or as dependent on natural systems for our life and our livelihood. And that kind of came gradually. And there are two stories that I think defined the company and defined the culture of the company, which is actually when I started to write this book, one of the questions I had is, because I'm primarily a writer, so I'd been at this place for 40 years. When I started, the company was 10 people and $200,000 a year. And now it's 2,000 people and 700 million a year. The difference, the culture is different, but it's also substantially the same. Much that was actually best in that culture of 10 people has survived to this point. So what led to that? And there were a couple of things I thought that were really important. And the first was the first big change the company made as a kind of moral decision. And that was in 1972. What we were famous for as a company, is that me? What we were famous for as a company was the hard steel piton. And the hard steel piton was something that you would, it's like a spike that you would hammer into the rock, and it would hold the rope and it would hold you under weight in the event of a fall. The invention of the hard steel piton meant that climbers could climb with many fewer pitons and much less weight on their bodies because they could be reused, they could be constantly hammered in and tapped out and removed. And the problem was one of success. But in 1972, there were many more climbers and no more places to climb. So climbers were going to the same places in Yosemite, the Shuangunks back east, El Dorado Canyon in Colorado. And every time you hammered in one of these little spikes, these little pitons, it actually widened the crack. So what the company realized was, what Yvon realized was, he's very way of making a living was destroying the sport. And it was also destroying the rock, which was, this was almost sacrilegious to a climber to harm the rock on the roots. The question was, is there anything that could be done about that? And there was a solution because British climbers had started to use these little aluminum nuts that you could twist into a crack without using a hammer, and it would hold the rope under weight. And it was a good system, but it's not something American climbers were used to. And if you're a climber of that time, and you're relying, there's a great reassuring feeling of when you hammer a piece of hard steel into a crack in granite that you don't get from daintily twisting a little piece of aluminum in. It was also a huge investment to the tools and dies to create aluminum chocks. It was a monumental for this little company. But he decided to do it, but the most important decision was to talk to people about it. Now, the climbing world at that time, we had some huge market share of 70-80% of the climbing of piton sold in the world. And the climbing community was so small, even though it was growing, that basically everybody was a friend or a friend of a friend or a friend of a friend of a friend. And that's how we approached them. I used to inspect ice axes for hairline cracks. And my feeling of responsibility was awesome. I mean, it was, that's hard. If you miss something that could actually injure or kill somebody who actually is a part of your extended community. But also that capacity to talk to people as friends is what helped us through this crisis. Because what we did is issue a catalog with a 12-page essay called The Whole Natural Art of Protection, which was part manifesto on why people should switch from pitons to chocks, and part user's manual. And to give you an idea of the effect of this piece, is that was catalog came out in June 1972. I arrived, and pitons at that point were about 70% of the business. And when I arrived in March 1973, chocks had become 70% of the business. So this was huge. The second story, you have to kind of flash forward to 1988, and we had become a clothing company, and we were doing pretty well. We were about $60 million a year. And for us, clothing was our soft business. I mean, in climbing, you dealt with a lot of iron and steel and aluminum, and you got dirty. And we'd almost changed from blue-collar workers to white-collar workers by going into the clothing business and selling natural cotton sportswear. And it was in the fall of 1988, we opened our third store in Boston. And after 3 days, we started to, our employees started to call in sick, headaches, stomach aches. And we thought, we closed the store down. And we called in an environmental engineer to check to see what the problem was. Paid his bill, and he said, it's all fixed now. And he said, well, okay, fine, what caused that? He said, oh, well, it was, we did the readings, and it was formaldehyde, off-gassing from the cotton clothes stored in your basement. And that was the first indication to us that clothing could have the environmental impact that it looked like it was going to have. We commissioned a study of the four major fibers we use, which are wool, nylon, polyester, cotton. And we expected polyester and nylon to be the most environmentally harmful because they're oil-based. And it turned out what we learned from this independent study was that cotton was by far the most environmentally harmful. And it was cotton was harmful not because of formaldehyde, which is really only an incidental harm, but because of the intensive use of chemicals in its cultivation. And we looked at this and we thought, well, this is big news. We make a lot of, cotton was 50% of our line. We said, is there an alternative? And we looked and we talked around, we visited. We knew that organic cotton was grown in California, it was grown in Texas and Turkey and China. So we started to look into the possibility of changing over from conventionally grown cotton to organic. And we made the commitment to do it in a year and a half period, once we figured out that we had the supply we needed. And we prepared that first season to pray for rain in the San Joaquin Valley, because we were going to buy most of the organic cotton grown. But what we didn't do is we didn't do our homework altogether, because we were kind of a naive little clothing company. We when we got to the stage where we talked to the people who make shirts or pants or shorts out of cotton, we found some resistance to the idea of using organics. The ginners need to clean their machines before organic cotton can be run. The spinners didn't want to work with organic cotton because it was a little bit gummy, and they were worried about its impact on their machines. And this went all the way down the line. And our experience, we had never worked directly with ginners or spinners or knitters or weavers. We had always just placed the purchase order and given them the patterns and the colors and the letter of credit and expected our shirts to come 6 months later. So this process was really difficult for us. And it was really difficult for some of the employees, the designers and the production people who are responsible for getting everything made. So all of a sudden they have a full workload and we say, oh, by the way, you can't just send a purchase order. Now go find us a spinner. go around the world and find somebody who will do this work. So we had some resistance. And one of the things we did was to take busloads of employees, about 30 or 40 at a time, to the Central Valley to go to a conventional field and then to go to an organic field. And it's one thing to say that we wanted to switch from chemically intensive cotton to organic, and that all sounds kind of abstract, but when you step off the bus and you go to a conventional field, it stank of the chemicals used to grow the cotton. The plants weren't actually alive. They were mechanically held in place by the soil but kept alive by fertilizer. There were no earthworms. There were no bugs. There were no birds. And then we took people to an organic farm, and that was a field. There was ground cover. There were earthworms. There were birds. And the cotton plants were actually alive. They were not just held mechanically in place in the soil. So the interesting thing for us is that nobody ever came back. I was actually one of the last people to go on these trips. So I would see people coming back from the trips who had been, you know, bitching about what we were doing. And nobody ever came back from one of these trips and said, this is still not worth it. Everybody said, you know, the company has made the right decision. This is tough, but we're gonna get it done. So a couple of benefits from this that I just wanna touch on. One is we really learned our business by switching to organic cotton. And it became a business advantage because we knew a lot more about the process of making clothing. We could negotiate better with suppliers. We could design. We were better designers after we made this decision. And the other thing is that our employees who were already, we had a culture of committed employees beforehand because so many were still climbers and surfers, or they ran together at lunch, or they thought Patagonia was cool. But there was a level of commitment after we switched to organic cotton that was palpably different. Everybody, the culture had been through something, everybody had been through it together, and we came out on the other side of it successfully. We delivered that first season, and we did not suffer a sales loss. We increased prices less than we thought we would, partly because we had learned more about our business. And we had done all this without a single customer asking us for organic cotton clothes. We had only done it because it was the right thing to do. I don't think we could have done it. I think it would have looked too hard to do to switch to organic cotton if we hadn't made the move 15 years earlier to switch from pitons to chocks. There is something that happens in a business culture, in any kind of culture, that stays with it. Even though very few of the employees in 1973 were still at the company in 1988, that success, that knowledge was still a part of our organization. And it gave us the confidence to make that move. I want to mention that set us on a road. I mentioned this before. If you're anytime you do anything, there are vicious circles, but there are also virtuous circles. And anybody who's a runner, you know that you want to improve your time. If you're a climber, you want to do a more difficult route. And I think in business, when you address some of these questions and you deal with them successfully, you want to deal with the next challenge that comes along. And one of the challenges for us was to look at the implications of what we were doing as a company, the environmental implications of what we made at a very deep level. We made a decision in 2005 to take back for recycling any product that we'd ever made. We studied the cradle-to-cradle theories of William McDonough, and we thought this would be a great thing to do. So we got a commitment from our supplier in Japan for the underwear and the fleece. We can collect it at our place in Reno, send it back to Japan, melt it down, re-extrude it, and make clothing of equal value. And we were down that path for a little bit, and we thought, well, you know, we've kind of got this wrong. We've kind of got this backwards. There's a reason that you go in order on the four R's of reduce, repair, reuse, recycle. Because you really shouldn't be making anything. You shouldn't be recycling something that shouldn't be made in the first place. Things should be repairable. So something that's perfectly good that wears out a part, that part, you should be able to replace that and make that product useful again. Particularly in clothing, we should be encouraging people to recirculate or reuse what they no longer wear. People get fat, get thin, they don't like red anymore, and the stuff piles up in the closets, and that is perfectly good clothing that should be in circulation. So we made the decision, and then we thought about reduce, and that was a really tough one, because we thought, we're a consumer products company, as they say, and how are we going to go about reducing, asking our customers to reduce consumption? Isn't that a funny thing for a company to do? So we racked our brains about this for a while, and what we did in 2011 is we took out an ad on Black Friday, which is the biggest shopping day of the year, the New York Times, it was full page, and the headline said, "Don't buy this jacket." And the arresting headline was matched by some copy that showed the point we were trying to make. Because what we showed, the product we showed, the jacket, was an R2. It's a mid-layer, and it's one of the most environmentally benign products we make. It's 40% recycled polyester, which is about as high as you can go and still get great performance. It's lasts forever. You know, people have had them 10 years, 12 years. And when you are finally done with it, you can send it back to us and we can send it to Japan and make a product of equal value. That we don't make many things that are that environmentally benign. But then we pointed out that it generated 21 times its weight in greenhouse gases, every one of these jackets. That everyone in the manufacture of every one of these jackets generated 2/3 its weight in scrap. We pointed out that the manufacturer of every jacket used enough water to meet the needs of a village for a single day. So the point we were trying to make is that everything we make, everything, has a cost to nature that's greater than we currently know how to repay. And that we should change our relationship to things to reflect, to have a kind of respect for the cost that everything that we make has. And we're not saying people shouldn't, we leave it at that. We leave it at that. Some people looked at that ad and they said, well, some people accused us of marketing. And I was actually the head of marketing at the time. And I wrote the ad. So it actually took a full board vote of the board because we were afraid that that would hurt business, not help it. And people then asked me for a metric, especially in the people in finance who are questioning my $58,000 for a New York Times ad. Said, you know, how are you going to measure success on this? And so I said, well, you know, if it increases sales, that'll be a sign that we're getting on our pulpit and we're actually greenwashing. We're making new business out of this. But if sales go down, we're committing suicide. So I'd be happy if after 3 weeks the sales of the R2 jacket were exactly the same. That was my metric. And it bore out. So 3 weeks later, the sales of that particular jacket had neither gone up nor down. And as a word, sales did go up that year, but we were having a good year anyway. There's an interesting, also people say, how can you make that kind of argument? How can you ask people to buy less? Aren't you going to eventually put yourself out of business? And the argument that we make back is that it's really just an extension of an argument for good quality. Some companies make things of very high quality, and they don't make anything else. And they don't worry that the replacement, that they're losing replacement on the value of the things that they sell, because they understand that they're building trust in their customer base, and that they'll get more customers and more friends along the way. And we feel that that's kind of an extension of that. We also look at one of the things I think that is really interesting is that if you look at what makes a successful business, and then you look at what makes a successful community, or you look at what makes responsible environmental practice, they are the same if you look in the long run. They're not the same if you look quarter by quarter. But if you're a business, and there are many businesses like this in Grand Rapids, that wants to be around for 50 years or 100 years, wants to be able to pass a business down from the owners to the children. If you want to have that kind of business, you have to build trust in the community. You have to have the confidence and the engagement of your employees. You have to have loyal customers who are also praising you to their friends so that you can build your customer base. You have to have the respect of the communities where you're engaged. And you also, if we want to be around in 100 years, we have to start to behave more environmentally responsibly and to take steps that let the planet take a rest. So we have to discover what it takes to have a more equal give and take with nature than we currently have. All of those match up with long-term business and with social and environmental concerns. I don't know how many, I think a lot of people in the audience are involved in business, and a lot of people ask us at Patagonia, and I think a lot of people ask B Corp, what are the reasons, what are the business reasons that for you to do the right thing? And I can come up with four, and they're all pretty important. The first is what we learned when we switched to organic cotton, is that when you undertake to be more socially and environmentally responsible, you learn your business better, and that gives you opportunity for new products or new services. It makes you design better. It just makes you a better business. That's the first. The second is that bad environmental behavior involves things that are very expensive and increasingly expensive: energy, water, waste, and pretty soon greenhouse gases. And the third is reputational risk. And this is what, in the age of the internet, we've seen so many companies overnight have to really fight to get trust back or their reputation back when something is revealed about their practices that becomes very unpopular with the public. And the fourth is almost the most important, is that the younger generation, the millennial generation, wants to have meaningful work. And if companies want to attract the best of that generation, they have to include as their definition of quality, as their definition of meaningful work, a social and an environmental component to that work. But I say this, these are all instrumental reasons, but I actually don't believe in the business case. And I'll tell you why. I think if you undertake this commitment on the basis of those instrumental reasons, it's so easy the first time you have a problem to kind of step back and say, well, we tried it, but it's not really worth it. And I actually don't think that people really engage in these activities for the business case. They want their businesses to thrive. They want to figure out how to do it and how to do the numbers. But the real reason to do it is moral. The real reason to do it is as a better citizen. And the real business advantage comes from the kind of trust you build when you do the right thing, not because you intend to do the right thing. Just want to talk a little bit about B Corp. For us, when we met, actually Fred Keller, I think, first got us involved with the guys from B Corp. And we looked at it and we thought, well, we do a lot of this stuff, but we're suffering from audit fatigue. We work with Fair Labor Association to check the conditions and pay in all the factories that sew our apparel. We work with Bluesign in Switzerland to vet the chemicals that go into the textiles that we use. This is another thing where we've got to go through some massive self-audit and figure out what to do. So we were a little skeptical. And we did a lot of it. And we thought, well, why do we have to be a B Corp? We've been on this path for a long time. But I think what kind of, there were a couple of things that convinced us. One is, what B Corp does is it allows a business to look holistically at your relationship to the finances of your business, your relationship to your employees, your relationship to your customers and community, and to your environmental impact. And it views that in a whole package. It also, it's independently verified. So if you're a certified B Corp, which is great for us, so every business has the capacity to kid itself, and the bigger you are, the more you can kid yourself. So we liked the idea of the independent verification. And the other thing it does is, that I've noticed, is it brings a sense of community to businesses that are on this path, the people who have decided to become B Corps. When you have something like a group of 400 business people or 800 business people in Grand Rapids do something that's taken up by New York City to be adopted by all of its business community, that's accelerating an impact for good that has had a very kind of slow progress. So community is the second reason. And the third reason for us was structure and succession. Because we're a privately held company with older owners, and the whole question of the children will inherit the company, but what if at some point they get tired of the responsibility of owning a company that size and they start to sell their stock, what happens? And being a B Corp, we're a legal benefit corporation in California, we were the first to become so, enables us to write our values into our business charter, our articles of incorporation, and effectively requires any investor who comes into the company to respect, honor, and want to help make thrive the culture that we've developed over 40 years. I think this kind of work is the kind of work we need to be doing for us as a species to recover grace. I think it's the kind of work that helps restore the wholeness of the sense of a biotic community of which we're a part. And the last thing I'd like to kind of allude to, I started off with this quote about awareness. No, I'm sorry, I started off with a quote about bankruptcy. And that now I've spoiled my punchline. Because I think awareness is also a process that happens in two ways, gradually, then suddenly. And the awareness of the environmental crisis has been happening very gradually, but when it does happen, which I think will happen suddenly, everybody in this room who is engaged, who has been engaged with these questions and engaged with these concerns and engaged with these at work or as a citizen, is going to have a responsibility to help bring along all of our brothers and sisters who are going to suddenly be aware of what the magnitude of this problem is and who will want to pitch in. So, with that, I'd like to open up for questions. Yeah. Well, the question is, can everybody hear that question? Okay. The question is, can you have a stockholder revolt with a B Corp? And all of the stockholders, there were two stockholders when this was started, now there are four. And it takes 100% vote of the stockholders to change the... To change the beneficial corporation status. Now, B Corp is now a legal status in 27 states. California was the seventh. I don't believe it's a legal status yet in Michigan, but it is in Delaware, where most public corporations are based, and Etsy is the largest public corporation. Maybe they're going public to be a B Corp. Yes.
I mean, Vaughn's book, I've Had People Go Drifting, he talks a lot about his, or more specifically, Patagonia's ventures to seek out like sourcing and these companies that, especially overseas, where you guys source from with your materials and things like that. I guess, what are your company's efforts today to kind of further that progress, especially with an expanding market?
Yeah. Well, one of the things we've done is actually shrink the number of factories we deal with. When we started to really, the question is, what are we doing to secure an innovative supplier base now that we're growing, because we've been growing as a company? And one of the things we've done is actually to shrink the supplier base in order to work more closely with fewer factories, to be more of a factor for them, to work more closely with them about environmental and social issues. That's at the level of social and environmental performance. In terms of innovation, we work with a lot of companies, and we have a long-term R&D department that looks at new materials. Yes?
At the ground level, what is the social impact that those partner companies look like? What are you able to drive? If I was working at Factory X or Factory Y that was partnered with Patagonia?
Well, quite a lot. And there's another organization I should mention. One of the things we discovered is, we have limitations. Let me actually go back a little bit. When I'm looking at this kind of 40-year period of what the next economy will look like, what would it take to create a kind of healthy economy? When we look at that, I see two things that are really important. And one is the stronger development of local business, because I think it's more honest business. And then the second is that when you're dealing with large companies and you're doing things at an industrial scale to reduce the harms you do. And that's something when the Walmart can have such a tremendous effect on the environment when it undertakes a very simple step to, you know, reduce the running time of its trucks, that kind of thing. One of the things we did in 2007, Walmart approached us and asked us, well, teach us about sustainability. And we said, oh, that's pretty funny. We're so small and you're so big. But the one joint project that came out of it was to invite 16 CEOs to a summit to set standards, environmental and labor standards, for the apparel industry. And this organization has taken root, and we now have over 100 members that make more than a third of all the clothing and footwear sold on the planet. So this organization is working on establishing strong social and environmental standards. Social is much harder, environmental is a little easier. And once that group starts, they're taking assessments of energy use, and water use, waste generated in thousands of factories. So that has a huge impact, because what we're doing is we're no longer acting as a single company, but we're influencing and working with other, creating new friends in the industry as a whole. There are other smaller steps. We recently found, in 2011, we found out that we had not in the apparel work, but at the textile level, and tier two level, we found human trafficking going on with five mills we dealt with in Taiwan, that they were using labor brokers to bring people over from Indonesia and from the Philippines and charging them outrageous amounts of money, like $5,000 to $7,000 for a two-year contract. And when we discovered that, we went to our suppliers and we said, we found this out. We want to work with you to eliminate this practice. And at first they were rather skeptical and resistant. But four of them, you know, said, yeah, we will agree to do that. And we negotiated with them so that they didn't have to, wasn't a sudden we're going to pull all our work out one day. It was by July 2015, we will not work with any mill that is using a labor broker. And the agreement that we actually worked out with these four suppliers then became adopted by the government of Taiwan as a standard for companies to get out of that practice. So there are lots of ways you can use your moral authority as a company, or your creativity as a company to change practices. There's some things that really do have to be done at an industrial level if you want to achieve change.
I'm interested in how you cultivated the relationship between employees as your company grew, because at the start, everybody had that common bond, but of course, as you started growing, those bonds would become bigger.
The question is, what happens in a company that's growing and the bonds that the original employees had, what happens when you start to add employees? It's interesting, we've had long periods where we didn't grow, and then we've had periods of growth spurts. And those growth spurts, it doesn't matter how many sales you add, it matters how many employees. If you add a lot of employees quickly, it puts a strain on the culture. It becomes more difficult to absorb those employees. But it used to be a lot harder. Partly when we were going down we were the only company like ourselves for a while, or the only ones we knew about. And it became the job of the culture to bring people on board. And now people come from other companies. Sustainability is a concern at other companies. They've had training in business or in textile skill school. So the language is more shared. But it's a delicate balance. What you want to do is to make sure that there's a kind of a tension sometimes between older employees and new employees, because everybody's afraid. The older employees are afraid the company has outgrown them, and the newer employees are afraid they're going to screw the company up. And what you want to do is have a period where everybody can work together and then begin to trust each other. Yes.
Your words about the moral case being more compelling than the business case, mm-hmm. and the importance of growing awareness mm-hmm. made me wonder what connections you see between communities of faith and sustainable businesses, if any, yet. I know it's kind of a new conversation related to social enterprise and religion, but I'm very curious what your thoughts are.
I don't know there isn't a lot, but I think that there's a growing sense among people of faith of an the need for environmental stewardship. And this is not necessarily just in liberal Protestantism, it's also among evangelicals. I work with a peer group of students at Yale. I work with people from the Divinity, the Environmental, and the Business schools to kind of sit down once a month and talk about some of these issues. Because I think the ground is really interesting for a good discussion. I think one of the things that we kind of lack, I'm a secular person, and I think one of the things we secular persons lack is a cosmology. that takes into account the wonder of the universe that we would all feel responsible for. But I can't create one on my own. So. Hi, yes? I'm sorry, can you stand please and repeat, because I have...
Your moral consideration goes into the animal product as well, like, when you're creating your apparel or clothing, do you use like a leather or wool?
Okay, thank you. Okay, the question is whether our considerations also apply when we're using animal materials from animals. And we've been... this is, it's been a gradual kind of journey toward responsibility, and this is one of the areas we've come to more recently. It came to our attention that the down used in our jackets was coming from geese that had been force-fed. So we went through a lot of very difficult steps to make sure that the supply chain does not include down from geese that have been force-fed or live-plucked. One of our best products, to my mind, is best projects, is we're working with ranchers in Patagonia, Argentina, who have raised merino wool sheep for generations, and they're all getting to the point where they're about to go out of business because Patagonia is so overgrazed. So they've undertaken a program with the Nature Conservancy and a man named Alan Savory, who came up with a system to move the sheep around that actually restores grassland. And there's a quote from one of the old ranchers that I really love. He said, all my life I considered myself a sheep rancher, and now I consider myself a grass farmer. And what I love about this project is it's not just a question of doing less environmental harm, which is usually all we can do. It's actually a regenerative for the environment. And the second is we're keeping a way of life alive that's, that will otherwise be threatened. And then the third is we actually get a better product because the way they raise this wool, we get a finer micron, so you get a lighter wool that insulates better. So we're looking at all this. We don't work with leather, but I wouldn't say we don't work with leather for moral reasons entirely. We just, it's too heavy a material for outdoor use. Yes.
Springboarding off of that, what kind of things is Patagonia doing to support Conservación Patagonica with Dutch Hopkins?
Yeah. The question is what we're doing to support Conservación Patagonica. This is really a project dear to our heart. Our original Doug Tompkins is an old friend of Yvonne's who started the North Face in Esprit and sold out his business to start to, he's bought over 1 million acres in Chile and Argentina and donated them to become national parks. And his wife is the woman who was once our CEO for a long time. And so we give them money and we've sent people down on, we sent employees down for like 2 weeks at a time, 12 to 15 employees to help cut down fences and build visitor centers and that sort of thing. And we also promote it through our catalogs and our website. And we've also done some film work. So, we love that project. Yes.
I'm curious about what ways, if any, being committed to being a part changes your view of competition or being considered competitors, or does it impact competition?
Yeah.
Yeah,
the question is how being a B Corp affects competition. And I think it's one of those things that help, that if more people start to understand what a B Corp is, and if they see that little sign on your window when they go into your business, I think it helps build trust. So in terms of competition, your advantage versus the company that isn't a B Corp, that gives you a little bit of a competitive edge. Until everybody's a B Corp.
Maybe one more question or
okay. Otherwise. A tough one, you can give me a really hard one. we've got two, and can I take both?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, so first to hear.
Your footwear partner for years was Wolverine Worldwide, which
right.
is 10 to 15
yeah.
mile per year. Can you talk maybe frame it in terms of your footwear line, how you make the decision to get into a product line and then exit a product line, how sustainability might play a role in those decisions?
Right. The question is about our partnership with Wolverine, which was a licensee that made Patagonia footwear for several years. And Wolverine was the only licensee we've actually worked with. And I think that both companies made a really strong good faith effort to make it work, but it was difficult for us to learn how to work our design process in with their design process. So in the end, we produced some really good shoes, but I think overall, they weren't really happy with the returns they were getting on the line, and we weren't happy overall with the entire line, although some of the things they made were marvelous. And then the last.
So you've spoken just a little bit about company culture.
Yeah.
And how you've got some buy-in from your employees.
Yeah.
As new companies, maybe sustainability wasn't part of their history. How have you got any good stories or good tips or tricks on how you've got employees really to champion the sustainability in the company and then maybe also a bit in their personal life?
Yeah. Well, you know, actually, Patty, personal life has been a big, I think that was a clue. Could everyone hear that? No, okay. The question is on company culture, and what you can do to foster commitment to doing the right thing among employees, and then also how that works out in personal life. And I think that personal life, there have been so many Patagonia employees who become friends, or who go biking together or go climbing together on the weekend, that that plays a huge role, the life on the side. But it also works the other way. It's interesting, I've been teaching classes to seminars to Patagonia employees, about 12 at a time. And if I talk to the Hispanic women who sew in the sample shop, who are not climbers, they're not surfers, and they didn't come in with any kind of huge desire to change the world. But they tell me, they're the ones who come up to me afterwards and say, you know, I started recycling, I started changing the food I feed my family because of what I learned on the job here. And now my 12 brothers and sisters who used to laugh at me, because I was the recycler of the family, they're all now doing that too. So that kind of, it spreads in all kinds of ways. And in terms of buy-in, I think I just read this wonderful quote from this Belgian businessman who said, if I can remember, it's a short story but a long sequence. He said, in order for people to be happy, they have to be motivated. In order for people to be motivated, they have to be responsible. And in order for people to be responsible in a company, they have to know who they're working for and why. And it has to be up to them to do the how. So one of the most critical things of buy-in is to really have to push that decision-making down as low as you can, so everybody has the sense of agency. And people already, I mean, at Patagonia, it really makes a difference to people that we're involved in this work, and they have a really strong sense of being citizens as well as workers, and that actually motivates them even more. You know, sometimes the environmental campaigns are more interesting than their daily work. Thank you.